we designed stadia all over the world, but when we came to Thomond Park, we realised this was somewhere very special. And it was a big challenge. People said, will you change the atmosphere? And we said, yes, we will. We'll just make it the same, but more so. And we like to think that's what we've done.
The main thing was to make sure that there was an even balance in terms of the number of spectators, to keep the balance in terms of the atmosphere. And I think, you know, the two bookend approach that we've taken with the arches and the shape of the stadium, we've kept people as close as we can to the pitch. We've made it as intimidating as we can by making it as steep as we can within regulations, and I think you know, it's looking good. The colours, everything adds to the atmosphere here.
The design team on these schemes must be allowed to let their imagination, their creation flow, and their creativity flow, and we were encouraged to do that on here. An important aspect of the brief is that the final design must be particular to Thomond Park. It must be special. It can't look like anywhere else. And again, we feel we've achieved that. This will always be the image of Thomond Park and Munster Rugby.
So what did it take to build this iconic 26,000 capacity stadium in the heart of Limerick City?
From the beginning, because of the, I suppose, long and fairly complex run-in on planning, one of the huge challenges we had was there was only 5 weeks from a grant of planning to first issue of the tender documents, which is an extraordinarily short term of length of time. So that in itself was an enormous challenge. I think partly because of that, and for various reasons, the client chose to use a design build procurement, and that means that the contractors became involved in making modified proposals. So that meant we got into a conversation, and then when we got down to the preferred contractor, PJ Hegarty's, we were really able to fine-tune and hone that design. And I think two of the things, Hegarty's first of all brought on their own team of very, very bright people, John McInerney as the general driving his army, and Ger Tierney and Sean Fahey in particular. And they then brought on board two fantastic firms, Banagher Concrete down from Offaly, for all the precast concrete. And they made a marvellous discovery in fines engineering. Because it was a design build operation where we actually moved on to Hegarty's team once they became the preferred bidder. So ourselves and the architects became part of Hegarty's organisation. So from that moment on, the design having been developed to about 85%, we were then on the same team to take that design and to hone it and fine tune it and look at the simplest way of building it. So in that sense, we were working together doing the same job on the same team. And I found them very, very inventive, full of energy. And sometimes they drove us, and sometimes we drove them. And I think we got over the line. And for me, it's a win, I think. And I hope the people of Limerick agree. I think they do.
Well, PJ Hegarty's have been delighted from day one to be involved in the tendering process, the bidding process, and to actually win the contract to construct, design and build this iconic project in Limerick. It is a project that obviously has captivated the soul of Limerick, the number of hits on our website, the actual interest in the building, and the actual, what it now looks like on the skyline of Limerick, has been a talking point throughout the city for the last 12 months.
The first element of work here on site was the demolition of the old Bohemian Stand, as everyone probably called it. The foundation for the structures started in earnest after that demolition works was completed. And two totally different sites the West End, the old bohemian side, was quite a rocky environment to work in. Whereas the East End side and the Knocklasheen Road side, Ballinenty Road side, well, we had to go into the dirt a bit to get a decent foundation. From a foundation starting point, the various columns and beams were assembled, erected and slotted into positions and subsequently grouted in, and the whole structure knitted together with a combination of both beams, columns, and that was a process that carried through for the main structure of the stand. Installation was carried out by Banagher Concrete, who provided the units made in their works in Banagher, obviously in County Offaly.
Here we can see one of the back breaker beams for the stadium being moulded. These beams are over 20 tonnes in weight and form part of the main support structure for the terraces of the stand. They were moulded with a mix of high-strength steel and self-compacting concrete. After curing for a number of hours, the beam is removed from its mould and then stored, ready to be delivered to site as it is needed.
In a building like this, it's all about the accuracy and the precision. And thankfully, we had a good team here working with us. We had a good team of designers, a good team of fabricators. And in this day and age, computers play a big part in it as well. And an awful lot of the calculations that would have been mind-boggling in the past allows these things to take place. And the geometry of the stand is all highly computerized. But even after it being highly computerized, someone still has to take the drawing, set it out on the ground. And that precision is true thanks to the competency of the team involved.
The first milestones we had was getting ready for the first match, but would have been the erection of the lighting poles which were on the site. They were the original lights that were here originally from Thomond Park. We had to get them up, one, for the match, but two, that they were so large and being in such a restricted site.
Had to be ready for the first match, and with a similar number of spectators to what was at the last match before demolition. And in order to allow that to happen, we put together the standing terrace on the west end, which was done using a precast structure.
With the installation of the stadium lights, the west stand terrace and the floors of the dressing rooms well underway, work commenced on fitting the upper raker beams to the east stand. The installation of these support beams was complicated due to their 20-ton weight and the 5 different points of connection required to support each beam. Specialised splice plates were fitted to the lower raker and another highly engineered plate to the top of the back support column. This would connect the steel supports to the concrete column and tie the structure together. One of the key aspects of the stadium design was the two trusses that would support the roofs of the stands. These trusses would be over 150 metres in length and weigh in at over 130 tonnes each.
For the big rainbow trusses, obviously wind loading is a dominant factor, and it's not an easy thing to quantify what the wind will do. And in fact, in this particular case, we commissioned a wind tunnel study, and we had a model built, and there's a technology called boundary layer wind tunnel technology, which measures the actual pressures from the wind on the surfaces of the roof.
Each truss would be supported by two concrete pedestals.
I suppose the next critical operation that was required for Thomond Park was the design of the four pedestals. We felt that on digging those, there's a massive congestion of steel required for the four pedestals, as you can see there in the corners. They're a conical shape. They have large bases underneath them. We had difficulty in shuttering them with the uplift of concrete because they're a conical shape. You have 2 meters at the top and 4 meters at the bottom, approximately. We had an uplift of concrete up to 50 tons on it. We had to use a self-compacting concrete, which eliminated the vibration required on the shutter because the shutter was made from GRP. The accuracy through the whole thing, through the rebar cage, through the shutter, to the setting out of the base itself, was very, very important. We had to achieve 10 millimetres really within the truss, that was our main aim, and we achieved that within specification.
The trusses themselves were fabricated off-site in sections by Foyn's Engineering. As each section was completed, it was transported at night to the site. Once offloaded, the various sections were reassembled behind the main stands. With everything in place, temporary towers were constructed on top of the east stand. These towers would support the weight of the truss until all three sections had been welded together. Additionally, four of the secondary roof trusses were put in place so the main truss could be anchored to the back of the stand. Work on site paused to allow the first match to take place. 2 days later, work started on installing the first truss.
We literally started from day one when I had a meeting with John McInerney of PJ Hegarty's. We went into an office and drew out a piece of paper, and John sat down and said, is this feasible and possible to put up a truss of this size? Is there craneage in the country to do it? And from the initial meeting, we went back to the drawing boards and said, yes, there is the cranes available. Then we decided that we'd formulate a plan as to how we would put the truss together. And with PJ Hegarty's, Foyn's Engineering and ourselves, we came, I suppose, across the solution as to how we were going to put up this major truss, which is possibly one of the biggest ever put up in the country. It had to be put up in three sections, the centre and the two ends. The centre section took an awful lot of planning, and before we even looked at putting it up, we had to go off and do drawings and do all sorts of site meetings as to where we could place the truss initially to build it, and after that then add how we were going to lift it. And on the first lift, in actual fact, we had four cranes on the job. Two big cranes and two secondary cranes just to turn the truss and put it into its upright position. We were initially talking maybe about 10 days, but in actual fact, we put it in 5 days.
With the first of these trusses in place and the second match completed, work continued on the structure of the west stand. Columns and beams were carefully fitted into place and the structure started to take shape. The floors of the stand are laid in between these structural beams by using precast concrete panels. A layer of reinforcing steel is placed on top of the precast panel. The floor is temporarily supported from underneath, and a layer of concrete was poured over the pre-prepared area. This process was repeated throughout the build for each level of the stand. Precast units were arriving on a daily basis from Banagher's and being slotted into place. With the pace of construction, it was vital that the tower cranes could be utilised as much as possible on site.
The number of complexities, like any time when you're setting up a site, you look at the tower cranes to see the coverage that they have in order to be able to put in the precast units. The maximum weight that we were looking at was the weight of the seating terrace units, which are 7.5 tonne, and that limited our tower crane. The tower cranes were able to lift weight of 7.5 tonne at about 35 metres, so everything has to be taken then from how you can best cover that area of which is defined by a 35 metre line. So in order to get the best coverage with the tower cranes, we use a system of putting the tower cranes on rails. The rails allowed us then to cover more of the stand, more so here over on the west stand, which had flat ground, which allowed us to get 100% coverage on it. And on the east stand, we managed to position the rails so that we got approximately 80%.
While final preparations were being made to lift the second truss over the west stand, work progressed on fitting the precast terracing units to the back rakers of the east stand. Significant progress was also being made on the roof of the east stand.
In order to be able to lift the arch up into the air, we had to look at the position of the cranes, which was very important. We couldn't actually construct the outer third of the building in its finality until the arch was up in the air.
Each truss had its own problems and challenges, in the sense that we had more room at the west side. The east side then we hadn't as much room, and we were confined by the building coming out and the old clubhouse there as well. So no two lifts are the same in any aspect of craneage. When they're doing a lift like that, both crane drivers are on radios, and there's a banksman or an appointed person that's coordinating the whole effort. The two crane drivers and the appointed person would be talking to each other continuously as to how to let in and let out the beam, the tolerances, you're coming too close, you let it in, let it out, and that's down to years of experience. That's something that can't be really taught. That's something that it's just inbuilt into the crane driver. The accuracy, like, is millimetres when it comes up to the end. One tube slots into another, so there's literally no room for error whatsoever.
Now that the two main roof trusses were in place for the first time, you really could get a sense of what the completed stadium would look like.
Once the main truss was in position, that allowed us then to start putting up the secondary trusses, and once the second truss was up, allowed us to start putting up the roof purlins, allowed us to start putting up the roof sheeting, allowed us to start finishing the back cladding of the building. Just an interesting fact that we're working out there, speaking to the steelwork fabricator yesterday, that we reckon that overall length of steel in the project is approximately about 10 miles if you were to put every bit of steel back to back together.
With the main roof truss in place, it was now possible to fill in the structure at either end of the stand. The back breakers were put in place and the terracing units were positioned on top of them. The tower crane constantly moved along the length of the stand, as it was required to assist with both the terracing units and to move the roofing materials.
Well, we at BCL Contracts, we put on all the roofing and cladding on both the stands, which amounted to approximately 20,000 square metres of materials, which is probably big enough to cover approximately three rugby fields. The roofing is made up mainly of aluminium sheets and polycarbonate roof clear lights. Because we were allowed input at design stage with the design team, bringing our expertise to the table, it eliminated a lot of inefficiencies during installation. Cladding at the back of the building, which is a perforated aluminium cladding, this allows natural light into the areas, and it also is quite clever because it allows you to see right across the city. And the low-level cladding is a metal shadow line cladding, which is single skin products.
Well, obviously, once the roofing was in, it allows us to start back cladding. Once we start back cladding, we start meaning that the building is dry. We can start putting together the finishing touches inside in the concourses, the hospitality areas. Any project is a challenging project, that there's an awful lot of different aspects involved. We have basically a mini hotel on one level.
With the stadium progressing rapidly, work began on fitting the seats to the terraces of the new stands. This required the fitting of over 16,000 seats. As the majority of games would happen in the evening during the winter months, it was critically important to have effective stadium lighting in place.
Clancy Contracts are very proud to be part of the stadium. Working together with Hegarty's, we were involved from the design, from the whole concept of the grounds. I suppose one of the major achievements was the lighting installation, which we'd be very proud of. We designed it together with Philips Lighting in Dublin, who have a lot of experience in stadium all over the world. Together in total, just for the pitch flood lighting alone, we'd have in excess of 500,000 watts of lighting, designed to a very high level for colour TV. They're backed up by two enormous generators, which are 800 kVA a piece, synchronised. To be sure, we can't afford for anything to happen during a televised match across Europe.
Well, Limerick has a huge history of building. It has a huge and very skilled craft set, and at no time did we ever feel the need to go very far from home. I mean, we looked at, obviously, contractors or subcontractors throughout the region and throughout the country, but our locals proved as good as any or better. So we're quite glad we used local people, and they worked very successfully. As I say, it's a Limerick project, it's iconic to Limerick, and everybody local wanted to be involved, so I presume they put an extra effort in getting the jobs.
When you look at the stadium, although we're talking about a very big building, enormous steel weights in it, you look at it, it feels very light. It feels almost alive. It feels like it could spring. It can't spring, but it feels dynamic. And this is because of the lightness of the steel. The engineer did a brilliant job, and particularly the glazing on the roof of the stand and the back make it a very light structure, and it gives it that very special quality.
Going forward, I hope that it's a job that I look back on with a lot of fondness, and thankful for the team that worked together on the job, and that hopefully for Munster and Limerick that the stadium brings them to a new level and gives the supporters many years of happiness.
With the extra capacity, obviously this is going to give Munster a further boost to having an increased voice in the support throughout the stadium now, with the additional, what is it, probably 15,000 people available to give Munster a bigger boost for each of their games.
This is the best bit about being an architect, to see buildings reach their fulfilment. And I think last night was very special. Stadia are different from any other architecture. The supporters finished the building off.